the name Lord Jesus Christ. We're excited what God is doing. Stay tuned for the next 30 minutes. Something exciting is coming your way right here from the Paxson Revival Center Church. You don't want to miss Wednesday night, every Wednesday night at 7:30 in the Word with Pastor Steve. On Wednesday night, I have more time to slow down and to minister with the Word of God to you. You just need to be here. Also, we pray for the sick. Great things happen every Wednesday night. I'll see you in the Word with Pastor Steve on Wednesday night. You don't want to miss Friday morning miracle service. I will be praying for your family. I will be praying for sickness. Do you need a miracle in your life? Be with us Friday morning at 10:30. Every Friday morning, God shows up in a great way. We'll see you here Friday morning for your miracle. You don't want to miss every Friday morning while we have a great time every Friday morning. Even in the summertime, we have a great time. You need a miracle, you be with us every Friday morning, every Wednesday night at 7:30. But today is going to be an awesome day. Just a couple of seconds, I'm going to take you into a live service where people's lives were being changed. We have been known for God's Hospital, a delivered center for over 50 years, where thousands and tens of thousands, you probably feel safe to say 100,000, 200,000 people that's coming in this place has been healed and delivered, set free by the power of God. You can be with us this morning at 11 a.m. Do you need a miracle in your family? You want to be with us. Great things are happening. Three great services here today. Early worship at 10 a.m., morning worship at 11, and 6 p.m. revival service. We're excited what God is doing into a live service where people's lives were being changed.
In Jesus' name, Father, in the name of Jesus, from the top of her head, are you hurting in your body, girl? In your back, I want you to just come right up this way. Because as you're walking, God is healing. As you're walking, God is healing. Father, we just speak healing in this back. From the top of her head to the soles of her feet, in Jesus' name, by the stripes of Christ, we speak healing in this back. In the name of Jesus, be thou healed. Be thou healed, every muscle, every tissue, every vertebrae. God, we just speak healing in Jesus' name. I want you to move. I want you to move back and forth. Hallelujah. Is the pain there? The pain's not there in Jesus' name. Somebody help me praise God. In Jesus' name, Lord, we ask you to work out every situation. We can't, but you can. Lord, we can't, but you can. You already started working, God, but we want to see it complete. Father, complete it. Now, God, touch her body. Lord, as she stands here this morning, cancer free. We want to say thank you, Jesus. Cancer free this morning in Jesus' name. Father, we're going to give you praise for how good that you are in Jesus' name. Jesus' name. Healing in Jesus' name. Healing. What do you need prayer for? For cancer. Which I felt that this morning. I believe today is your day, brother. I believe today is the day. Healing in Jesus' name. Healing. And come on, church. I need somebody to help me stand in agreement. Somebody help me stand in agreement. In the name of Jesus, Father, we just denounce this cancer. I speak healing in this body. I speak life in the name of Jesus Christ. I speak life in the name of Jesus Christ. I cast out that fear. I cast down every imagination that exalts itself against the kingdom of God. And Lord, I just speak healing. Healing in Jesus' name. Healing in Jesus' name. Come on, church. If this was your son, this was your husband, this was your brother, you would want God to do something. Father, in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, we speak life. We speak healing. We speak healing. We speak healing. Oh, Holy One, Holy One.
Are we excited what God is doing? You can leave the house of God on Sunday morning saying, I've been touched by the power of God. Make your plans to be with us right here on today, right here at 11 a.m. I'm going to be preaching and praying for you. Don't miss what God is doing. Go to our webpage, PaxsonRevivalCenter.com. Find all the information about the church. On the bottom of the screen, some prayer lines. Hallelujah. Some numbers if you need the prayer today, some spiritual people waiting to pray the prayer of faith for you right now into the preaching of God's word.
The Bible says in chapter 1, verse number 2 of Nehemiah, that Hananiah, one of the brethren, came and certain men of Judah, and I asked them concerning the Jews that had escaped which left of the captivity concerning Jerusalem. And they said unto me that the remnants are left of the captivity. There's a province are in great afflictions and reproach, and the wall of Jerusalem is broken down, and the gates therefore are burnt with fire. And it came to pass when I heard these words that I sat down and I wept, I mourned, and I fasted, and I prayed to God of heavens. You may be seated. Today we want to talk about Nehemiah. The word Nehemiah means comforter, understanding. What is the Holy Ghost? The Holy Ghost is our comforter. So on this Pentecost Sunday, I'm so happy that I'm ministering on Nehemiah, because Nehemiah means comforter. His name is a type of the Holy Ghost, is a type of the Holy Spirit. And Nehemiah come to the city of Jerusalem, and he seen the walls were torn down, the gates were burned, and it looked like they were hopeless. But Nehemiah began to be a type of a comfort to the people in the city of Jerusalem. He began to bring help in, and that's what the Holy Ghost does for us. Nehemiah began to give some hope, and that's what the Holy Ghost does for us. So when we understand something about a wall, a wall is something to keep something out, and a wall is keep something in, and that's what the Holy Ghost does. The Holy Ghost will be a cover on the top of you. And so as we understand that God is wanting to keep some stuff in, just as Moses' mom took a little basket and she began to pitch it on the inside in order to keep the water out. Just like Noah he took the ark and he pitched it on the inside. Hallelujah. And he pitched it on the outside. This is what the Holy Ghost does for us. We know the blood of Jesus covers us, but we also know the Holy Ghost begins to come into our life in order to bring protection unto us. When we get into the place that we look like we have no hope, and the way that the children of Israel were, it looked like they had no hope whatsoever. But here come Nehemiah, just a layman in the church. Nehemiah began to come and say, you know, there's something that we can do. We can rebuild this wall. It reminds me of the story that I find in 2 Kings chapter 3. In the book of Kings, in 2 Kings chapter 3, if you go with me to the book, if you go with me to 2 Kings chapter 3, the Bible tells us a story that the man of God told them in chapter 3, 16 to 2 Kings. He says, I want you to make the valley full of ditches. I want you to fill the ditches up whatsoever. And he said, for thus saith the Lord, you shall not see no wind, you shall not see no rain, but the valley is going to be filled of the water. So the prophet says, when you get up the next morning, you're not going to see any rain or wind. You're just going to to see the results. And I've come to preach to you today and to prophesy into your life today. There's coming water into your life. There's coming. The water is the type of the Holy Ghost, the type of the Holy Spirit. The water is going to flow into your life. I believe the Holy Ghost is coming. Some of you have been in a spiritual drought just like they were. They was in the spiritual drought, but they begin to dig, and as they begin to dig, the water begin to flow. Can I say the spirit of Nehemiah, the Holy Ghost, is going to come on this place today. When you seem like the enemies come up against you, don't accept the enemy's report as if the enemy has the last to say. You need to get you a dig. You need to get you a shovel, and you need to start digging. You need to start saying, I'm going to dig the word of God, because I believe that the book of Nehemiah is all about a revival taking place. And that's what's been happening here in this church. It's been a Holy Ghost revival. But I want the revival to get into your house. I want some restoration to come into your house. I want God to come back in and to restore some things that's been torn apart. But what is it going to take? It's going to take us doing some work. It's going to take us saying, okay, Pastor, I am ready and I am willing to get on the wall. I'm really ready to get on the wall. I know that it's kind of shaky in my life, but I'm ready to go on the wall. I'm ready to reestablish. It's not easy to work for God. It's not easy to do things for God, but you need to get back up on the wall and not let the devil to get you down. Why is it that we don't have any power in the church anymore? We've got off the wall. We've let the troubles come into my life, but I come to tell the devil this morning, I'm back on the wall, and I'm doing something great for God, and I'm not going to come down. I'm going to preach the word. I'm going to practice the word. I'm going to live the word, and I'm going to dig me a ditch so the rain will start coming. I want the Holy Ghost revival into my life. As we look around and we understand the word says the Holy Ghost is coming, I really believe as Nehemiah began to dig, as he began to bear, that he heard voices, and the voices of accusation come, says, you build that wall, said it's going to fall down. You build that wall, and that it's not going to stand. You build that wall in just 52 days. Just in 52 days, the fox will run up that wall and it'll fall over. I've got news for the devil this morning. I'm coming out of what the accusations that the devil says. I'm standing on the word of God. Well, what are you going to use to build those, rebuild that wall? Let me show you what he's going to use. He's going to use old, burnt, unlevel blocks that used to be something, but the fire burned them up. You've been through the fire, and God said, I'm going to use those old burnt stones that you've had. I'm going to use that old burnt life that you had. I'm going to use that life that it looked like your world is falling apart. God said, I'm going to use broken things in your life. God said, I'm going to use things that are despised by men. God said, I'm going to pick you up when men has pushed you over. I'm going to pick you up when you've been through the fire. I want you to hear what Paul said that God's going to use. Hear what he said, 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse number 9. He said, know you not, the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God. Be not deceived, neither fornicators, idolaters, or adulterers, or infamous, or abusers of themselves with mankind, nor thieves, or covetous, or drunkards, or revilers, or extortioners shall inherit the kingdom of God. Hear what verse 11 says. But you, me, been washed, you've been sanctified, you've been justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ by the Spirit of our God. We didn't, when we come to God, we weren't so all pretty and our hair all fixed up. And no, get straight. You come to God, you was a drunk. You come to God, you was running around. You come to God, you was a thief. You come to God, you was selling drugs, doing drugs, using drugs, and drugs had a control of you. But you're not that way anymore. You've been washed by the blood. blood of Jesus Christ. What did God do? God took those old burnt stones in your life and he said, I'm going to use those old burnt stones. I'm going to use those rejected. Oh, I just love to read the word of God. And God used rejected things. He uses broken potteries. He used broken lives. He used people that's been cast out. He used it. David, he was an adulterer. He was a murderer. But we preach about David and we sing his songs. So he must have made it okay with God. Yeah, he looked next door and he lied and he cheated. And he, oh, but look at what God done. David, understand of the grace and the mercy of God. Look at Jacob, how Jacob messed up. But that's not how he ended his life. I'm not here to preach how you were. I'm here to preach how you're going to be. Because God is going to rebuild the wall that is in your life. When we understand and I begin to preach, prophesy that there's coming a rain, you have to prepare yourself for a revival. Revival just don't accidentally come up. Now, when we think about today being a Pentecost Sunday, Pentecost didn't start in the New Testament. I know we preach about it, but it's actually at the same time, Pentecost at the end of the 7-week long journey that the children of Israel come out of Egypt to get the Torah, to get the word of God. After 7 weeks, they begin to come and leave out of the land of Egypt, of the land of not enough, to the land of the promised land, to the land of more than enough. I'm leaving what I used to be, and I'm going on to get what God promised me. In the Old Testament, we can find God giving the Logos. We can find him giving the Word of God. But in the New Testament, we can find God giving the Holy Ghost. The Old Testament begins to prophesy about Jesus coming. The New Testament begins to prophesy about the Holy Ghost coming. And why? Because we need both of them. We need something to come in our life. And within those 1,500 years that were taking place, waiting for the promises of God, now we get to Pentecost Sunday. How did the Bible tells us in the book of Acts 1 and 8, you're going to get power. Then we get over to Acts chapter 2 and 1. Go with me, because this is where I'm going. Because some of you don't have that Nehemiah covering. Some of you don't have that power because you don't have the Holy Ghost. Now let me tell you, Holy Ghost is not tongues. That's the evidence of the Holy Ghost. The Holy Ghost, and I'm going to mess with some of your theology a little bit this morning. I can't teach you how to speak in the Holy Ghost because it's a heavenly language. It was a language that, you know, because when we pray, we won't pray God kill him, but that ain't what God wants us to pray. Hear what he said in Acts 2 and 1. And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all accord in one place. If I could get everybody here for the next 20 minutes to get on one page, if I could get everybody in this building not to be thinking about the hot dogs and hamburgers and the chicken and the ribs tomorrow. If I can get you, it's not thinking about what somebody done you wrong this week and how you're going to get even with them this week. No, if I can get all of us on one page, they come together in the upper room. They come together with one thing. I'm waiting on the promise. I'm waiting on the promise. I'm waiting on the promise. Y'all know how you were on Christmas Eve. On Christmas Eve, you couldn't sleep. Every little thing that you done, you run out of the door and you look to see if the presents was there yet, because you had expectation that Santa Claus was going to come and bring you something. I'm not talking about Santa Claus bringing you anything. I'm talking about you getting a promise of the Father that cannot lie, to give you power that you can overcome every situation you have in your life. And the Bible said, verse 2 said, suddenly there come a sound from heaven as a mighty rushing wind, and it filled the house they were sitting in, and they appeared unto them cloven tongues as a fire, and it set up each of them, And they were filled with the Holy Ghost, and they begin to speak with other tongues as the Spirit begins to give an utterance. What's happening to the church world today? We got too many people sitting in the supper room, hello, and not enough of people in the upper room. We got too many people sitting low instead of saying, I'm going to get up because I want a visitation from God. Isaiah began to tell us in Isaiah chapter 28 and verse number 9, whom shall teach knowledge, and whom shall he that understand doctrine? Them that are weaned from the weak and draw from the breast. For the precept must be on precept, precept on precept, a line upon line, and line here a little and there a little. And with a stammering lips and another tongue will he speak to his people. God said, I'm going to give you a language that's to be far above what you speak, and you don't understand it. This morning, when some of you come up here to receive the Holy Ghost, don't stand here and try to speak English. Let God give you a language. When it don't sound right to you, it's not coming from your mind, but it's coming from your heart. It gets in your lips, and I don't know what I'm saying. I don't have that interpretation, but it's something that's flowing out of me. It's a stammering lips. It's something that says, God, I want you more than I want anything else. I want more of you and less of me. What does the Holy Ghost do? The Holy Ghost takes out all of that pride that you kept a hold of. The Holy Ghost takes out all that hatred that you got to kept a hold of. Isaiah says, in Isaiah 28 and 12, to whom he said, this is the rest. Somebody say rest. Because some of you are weary. You know why you're weary. You're not letting the Holy Ghost give you the rest. You're not letting the rest come upon you here. And so wherein you may be caused the weary to rest. This is the refreshing, yet they will not hear. In the Holy Ghost there is comfort. In the Holy Ghost there is peace. I watch these mamas come to church. And the baby got shot last night. The baby laying in the morgue this morning. I watched the people come to church, and she's standing weeping and crying. But she made her way to the house of God because she said, the Holy Ghost will be my comforter. If I could just get the Holy Ghost to rebuild my walls around about me, reestablish who I am. Oh, but Pastor, I want the blood. I ain't taking nothing away from the blood because you ain't going to get the Holy Ghost. I'm going to deal with it in a minute. You ain't going to get the Holy Ghost. Holy Ghost ain't going to come and rest upon you. And you filthy and unclean. I need a hush up because some of you are going to cut me off. He's looking for a clean and holy vessel. And if you're clean and holy, he said, I want to come on you. I want to give you power. I want to come on you. I want to give you peace. I want to come on you, and I want to give you rest. John chapter 15 and verse 26. But when the Comforter is come, whom I will send unto you of the Father, even the Spirit of truth, which proceedeth from the Father, the Holy Ghost, Jesus said, is going to testify of me. The Holy Ghost ain't going to come talk about himself. He's going to come bear witness of Jesus, again in John 16 and 13. Howbeit, when the Spirit of truth is come, he shall guide you into all truth. He shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he hear, that shall he speak, and he will show you all things to come. Some of you think, well, the Holy Ghost is just speaking in tongues. Hallelujah. Oh, no. He's my inside information. He's the Spirit that speaketh unto me, uttered things to me that I should not be able to even know, telling me things that my enemy's up to. The Holy Ghost will come and tell me when the enemy got a trap set for me. The Holy Ghost will come and tell me, you just stand still and let me work on this one here. You just stand still. And some of you still think it's about the tongue. Oh, no, no, no. My daddy used to preach it like this. He said, when you buy a pair of shoes and they tie up, the tie wouldn't be any good if it didn't have a tongue in the middle of it. The tongue is a flapper in the pair of shoes, you know. He says, that string will get tied all up with your sock and you won't be able to tie it very tight, but because of that tie, because of the flap, because of the tongue of the shoe, then the tongue of the shoe will enable you to tie it with the gout getting tangled up with your sock. And some of you ain't got the Holy Ghost, and some of you used to have it, but you ain't built yourself up. I'm going to deal with that in a minute. I'm running out of time already. Because we need the power of the Holy Ghost to come in our life. Let me go on. And the Bible said in Mark 6:17, these shall signs shall follow them that believe. In my name they shall cast out devils, and they'll speak with a new tongue. You used to speak evil thing, but God said, I'm going to give you something to speak. See, when we begin to get in unity together, God said, I want to use you. God said, I want something to happen. Now, David and his men wanted to bring back the ark, the presence of God. David and his men said, let's go get him. Let's go get it, because we've seen how Obadiah's house.
Oh, we love what God is doing right here at the Paxton Revival Center Church. I love Paxton Revival Center Church. I love these people. Hallelujah. God is just raising up great leaders and ministers, and God is just doing some awesome things right here at the Paxton Revival Center Church. We invite you to be with us. Three great services here today, 10, 11, and 6 p.m. Make your plans to be with us. We want you to be a part of what God is doing. Do you need a miracle in your life? Be with us. Go to our webpage, PaxtonRevivalCenter.com. If you'd like to have a word from Pastor Steve every day, Facebook, I don't do birthdays and the other stuff, but I love preaching the Word of God. Just type in Pastor Steve Dobbs, and we will speak something into your life every single day. Until we see you in these miracle services here today, may God bless you. Be our prayer.